Good afternoon, everyone. And welcome to this really lovely event. I'm Scott Waugh, the almost former Executive Vice Chancellor and Provost here at UCLA. And it's really great to be with all of you here today. I'm glad so many of you showed up. This is a wonderful occasion. We're really celebrating the establishment of the Thomas E. Lifka Chair in History and the installation of Professor Kelly Lytle Hernandez as the inaugural chairholder of the Tom Lifka Chair. Tom, I think as most of you know, has been a treasured part of the UCLA community for more than 40 years. He's occupied various important roles in the university, and I think I work with him closely on a whole number of very important issues. He came to UCLA, I'm told, in 1982 as Assistant Vice Chancellor for Student Academic Services, and was later appointed Associate Vice Chancellor. During his tenure at UCLA, he devoted his energy and talents to recruiting undergraduates, admissions, helping modernize our procedures for student registration and record keeping, and contributing to our efforts to increase diversity, especially the number of African-American students here at UCLA. That's a kind of dry way of saying that he was really instrumental in engineering the admissions of a really outstanding student and outstanding and diverse student body here at UCLA. And he really brought us, I think, into the modern age and helped establish the policies that laid the foundation for what is a very outstanding and very diverse student body. So we have owed Tom a great deal in his administrative capacity. It's also important to understand that he was also an academic. And Tom is a founding member of the UCLA History Board of Advisors and remains involved with the History Department. As an educator himself, Tom understands how much an endowed chair can contribute to the mission of the university and how important it is to support the faculty in the ways in which they deserve that kind of support. I personally want to thank him for his generosity to the university and to the History Department and his support in establishing this endowed chair in history, which is really a magnificent gift. And I can't think of a better inaugural chair than Kelly Lytle Hernandez, a rigorous scholar, an engaged public intellectual, a committed teacher, somebody also committed to service in the university, and now is director of UCLA's Ralph Bunce Center for African American Studies. She occupies a very important role in the university, not only as a scholar, but also as, and not simply as a director, but as somebody who really can help us carry out our mission of diversity and supporting everybody in the university in an equitable and inclusive way. So we're very proud to have you. We're lucky to have you. And I wish you best in this new role. I'm sure you're going to occupy the chair with dignity and greatest accomplishment. And now it's my pleasure to turn over the program to somebody substantive, the Dean of Social Sciences.
Thank you, Scott. I'm happy to hear that I'm substantive. But anyway, this is a wonderful day for the division and for the Department of History. It gives us the opportunity to celebrate two outstanding individuals, Tom Lifka and Professor Kelly Lytle Hernandez. Tom, thank you for the generosity you have shown in establishing the Thomas E. Lifka Chair. Your gift is all the more important because as an academic and an administrator at UCLA, you know firsthand the impact of your support, which we see being realized here today. I would like to take this opportunity to also acknowledge Tom for the important role he played for many years as assistant and then associate Vice Chancellor for Student Academic Services. Not only was Tom instrumental in UCLA's efforts to increase enrollment of underrepresented students, he was also a leader in improving the campus lives of our LGBTQ students. As a member of FARS and later as his chair, I had the opportunity to work with Tom in the early 2000s as UCLA was struggling to maintain its commitment to providing access to outstanding underrepresented students within the constraints imposed by California Proposition 209. Tom, UCLA is grateful for your dedication and service. As the inaugural Lifka Chair holder, Professor Kelly Lytle Hernandez is worthy of this honor for all the reasons that Scott mentioned and much more. She is an outstanding scholar whose research directly impacts our community and exemplifies the best of UCLA. When I stepped down as director of the Ralph J. Bunce Center for African American Studies in 2017, after 15 years in that role, I knew the center was in great hands when Kelly took over as director. 2 years in as director, Kelly has taken the center to new heights. Her amazing million-dollar Hoods Project, which we're going to hear about today, empirically documents the staggering cost of mass incarceration. It has not only informed policymakers through the best traditions of engaged scholarship, but has also provided a training ground for our students to learn important research skills as they pursue their desires to make a difference. I could go on and on. Suffice it to say, there is no more deserving candidate than Kelly Lytle Hernandez to serve as the inaugural holder of the Thomas E. Lifka Chair. I am pleased now to welcome the Chair of the History Department, Carla Pestana, who will formally introduce Kelly.
Good afternoon and welcome. As Darnell said, I am the Chair of the History Department, Carla Pestana, and thank you, Darnell, for that introduction. It's a pleasure, a real pleasure, to welcome all of you to the installation of Kelly Lytle Hernandez as the holder of the Thomas E. Lifka Chair in History. The establishment of endowed chairs is very important for the university and for the department. They help us to recruit and retain excellent faculty, a sort of faculty that UCLA is known for. So we're very grateful to Tom for his help in this regard. Today we celebrate my colleague Kelly on her appointment as the first Lifka Chair holder. Kelly received her bachelor's degree in ethnic studies at the University of California in San Diego, and her PhD here in the History Department at UCLA. Her research on race, immigration, and mass incarceration has established her as one of the leading voices in the field. She's published multiple award-winning books, including Migra, A History of the U.S. Border Patrol, and City of Inmates, Conquest, Rebellion, and the Rise of Human Caging in Los Angeles. For the latter publication, Kelly was awarded the James Raleigh Prize from the Organization of American Historians, the Atherin Prize from the Western Historical Association, the 2018 John Hope Franklin Book Prize for the American Studies Association, and the 2018 American Book Award. She's also, as we'll hear more about today, the principal investigator of this very important project, the Million Dollar Hoods Project, which maps the fiscal and human costs of mass incarceration in our city. This project and the team that works on it has won a 2018 Freedom Now Award from the Los Angeles Community Action Network, and Kelly herself, for her leadership in this project, was awarded the 2018 KCET Local Hero Award. In addition to all this, she's recently been named the director of the Bunce Center for African American Studies, and I, on a personal note, have to say that Kelly is one of my most outstanding colleagues within the History Department. She's wise, she's gracious, she's always willing to advise me and to help us as a department and as a university. So it gives me an enormous pleasure to introduce my colleague and friend, Kelly Lytle Hernandez, the Thomas E. Lifka Chair holder in history.
Oh, good afternoon. It's really great to see so many friends and colleagues and new friends as well. Of course, I need to thank everyone who made today possible. The donor who brought us all here, thank you for your generosity, but also thank you to the History Department and to the division and, of course, the entire university. I want to begin by thanking Tom for his generosity to the History Department and your dedication to the historical past and your own work and the work in supporting the department. It's really been a pleasure to get to know you over the last years and from coming to this moment. And I didn't know that we were going to share so much in common, we're a value system. We share a commitment to equity, to access, and to excellence here at the University, UCLA, one of the world's leading public institutions. You, of course, in your career in student affairs, you spend a lot of time, a lot of sweat, a lot of energy opening up the doors of the university. To Black, to Brown, to Needle, to first-generation students, and making this a welcoming place for a new community, a new generation of students. So that's the work that Tom has done.
because of you and the work you have done to open this university, I am truly honored to be the inaugural holder of the Thomas Fiscal. I have to say, I have to admit, I was a little bit nervous to meet the donor. I wasn't sure we were going to get on and take it, right? I do a lot of radical oppositional work, and I was concerned. And we met, and we sat, and we talked, and we really shared a value system about who belongs here at this university and who can provide here at this university. Just an enemy to bury your name in this place. And I think because of our shared commitment to students and to access and to equity and to excellence, what I wanted to do today was not talk about the more academic scholarly work that I'm doing right now, writing a book on the Mexican Revolution, on the historical work. I wanted to really highlight the community-engaged project that I'm leading called Million Dollar Hood. So I'm going to spend a couple of minutes. What I want to do is talk about that Million Dollar Hood, how we begin, who we are, what we've accomplished, what's next, and most importantly, what matters about the work that we're doing and how we're doing. So this is my party today, so I'm going to get down in the way that I'm used to getting down. So it's okay. If someone told me that there was a mic that I can walk around with, can I grab it back? Million Dollar Hoods, we map the fiscal and the human cost of mass incarceration. What that means? Okay. Thank you. Los Angeles, if you don't know, operates the largest jail system in the United States, which incarcerates more people than any other nation on earth. So if we're going to understand the crisis of mass incarceration, we have to do it from the perspective of Los Angeles, to a certain degree. Now, the issue is that about 10 years ago, when I started doing research on the rise of this crisis in LA, there were a couple of presumptions about the crisis. One, the presumption was that mass incarceration comes out of the American South, moves through the Jim Crow era, becomes this thing called the new Jim Crow. We saw it in the world. I agree with that 100%. The work that I've been doing adds a little bit to it. Also, we have to think more of those terms when we talk about mass incarceration. So, African Americans absolutely are most disparately impacted communities in mass incarceration. Also, Native people. We don't talk about the Native dimension of mass incarceration. We've got to bring that into the history. And we also don't talk about the diversity of human beings in the United States. There are forms that are outside of our jails and our prisons. It's also immigrant protection, for example. What would it mean to bring all of these stories into conversation? Well, I thought about 10 years ago, and LA again is a really good place to tell that story. Here we have a very large population of the communities that are most distantly impacted by mass incarceration. We have the largest Mexican population in the United States of America, the largest Black population in the West of Mississippi, the largest urban Native population in the United States, and one of the largest homeless houseless populations in the country. So again, if we're talking about all the communities that are distantly impacted by mass incarceration, LA is a really good place to think about this. So for all these reasons, I went and I wrote this book, City of Immigrants, which tracks the rise of mass incarceration here in LA, from the Spanish community period, right up to the outbreak of the Waugh rebellion in 1965. And in writing the story, what I discovered is that, yes, the prison industrial complex and the museum play are absolutely real. But when you look at it from the perspective of American West, there's another dimension that's at work in our nation's jails, prisons, and detention centers. And that dimension has to do with the conquest and colonization of American West, really coming out of this iconic image of the nation of American West as a white settler project moving across the continent, claiming land from Native peoples, removing Native peoples from that land, and then imagining a white settler community replacing Native peoples in that land, or in that land. Now, this project of eliminating Native peoples and eliminating disappearing racialized outsiders and sexual outsiders from the white settler community, I argue in this book, is that the center and the pillar of the project of mass incarceration. So that, in fact, of this incarceration, yes, is a prison industrial complex, thus extracting profit from bodies, absolutely, and that's a racialized project. It is also a project of mass elimination. But as the settler community could meet here in the American West, our jails, our prisons, our detention centers, our producing operations, were dedicated to the project of eliminating more people and disappearing their families. Was a pretty stunning project for me. I have become comfortable with the notion, not happy with it, but comfortable with the notion of the prison industrial complex. This is about profit, about extracting profit from bodies. And it really took me up and unsettled me to think about settler communism and colonization and elimination being the higher punchline of what's happening in the jails, our prisons, and our detention. Well, first, we learn from the people who have done it before us. We stand upon the shoulders of giants who lived with legacies. And so I thought about the work I had done for City of the Night. And what I knew was that the Los Angeles Police Department and Los Angeles Sheriff's Department have destroyed the vast majority of their historical documents. So when I went to write City of the Night, there wasn't much of an evidentiary trail for me to follow. I had to go and find the work to do it. The words of the people who have fought this system, who have fought the rise of mass incarceration, and I collected what their records. Their records are the people who have rebelled against the rise of mass incarceration, and these are the record sets that had rebelled against the destruction of the LAPD. So I call these records the Rebel Archive. The Rebel Archive of the Native Indigenous peoples who fought back against their colonization in the 19th century, particularly here in Los Angeles. It's the records of Native folks and Black folks and immigrants who have all protested their colonization, their pollution, and their children. So I knew historically that the Rebel Archive is the people who called the killer. And so I started hanging out with the Rebel Archive today. And I found the people who are really engaged at the front line of the movement and mass incarceration here in Los Angeles. Many people. So we're talking about the Vera Institute. The Vera Institute similar that the front line of their movement and mass incarceration. Also, the Justice Coalition, the Justice LA Valley Coalition, LA County, Los Angeles County Action Network, many community-based organizations are fighting colonization, policing, and incarceration. So it's been a minute with them about a purpose to I went to a lot of community meetings, I hung out, and I listened very closely to the Rebel Archive. What the Rebel Archive has taught me was a couple of things. First, at a single meeting with the Lady Mary Jones Coalition, people were sitting around saying, look, we know who's getting arrested. It's me. It's my son. It's my cousin. It's my neighbor. It's all of us. We know who's getting arrested, and we know on what charges. But every time we go to the LAPD and the LA Sheriff's Department with the data on what is happening to our communities, we're going to give a call. Hold on. That's what I do as a sponsor, right? We go after data. We go after evidence. That's what I'm thinking. Maybe we can do something with this. So, for these communities, we submitted calls from the Public Record Act request, and we won the data from the LAPD and the LA Sheriff's Department. Part of this lawsuit that just completed. Once we got this data, which included 27 categories for their team, every person, categories that include every person who's arrested by the LAPD and the Sheriff's Department, your name, your age, your height, your eye color, what charges you were arrested on, what time of day you were arrested, what time of day you were released. And all of that, we sat down and said, okay, we're going to do all this information. We've got this big data. We've got millions of bits of information. What are we going to do with it? And we talk about the work of this man here, Eddie Ellis. When Eddie Ellis was incarcerated at Green Haven Prison in New York, he ran a study group. And in that study group, the men who were coming through year after year after year began to realize that that the men who imprisoned that young woman are trying to think of 7 victims in that. And with this insight, I started at Columbia University in Oxford, used to develop a project called $1 Million Blocks. And the $1 Million Blocks project, what it does, is that there's a geography to national conservation. We also have an economy to national conservation. I put those two ideas together and map how much is being spent to wrap people up for the neighborhood in Chicago, New York, and other places. And they found that many neighborhoods and many blocks spend $1 million per year to spend to wrap up local residents. Hence, the $1 Million Blocks project. When we brought this to Los Angeles, you know that it was not a vertical city, it was a horizontal city. So blocks don't make sense to us. So we just took this and we sized it a little bit. We said, well, we'll do the $1 Million hood, the $1 Million neighborhood. And what we have done is we have mapped. We take an idea. And we've mapped every community in Los Angeles, and we've made our hosts go on the phone and made it home tonight. We've mapped every neighborhood, where more than $1 million have been spent per year to lock up local residents and the local jail system. We've found that in some neighborhoods, tens of millions of dollars have been spent in the last few years locking people up in the local jail system. We are also the only source of the drivers of incarceration in those neighborhoods. And there are people that are trying to tell you that it's assault, murder, rape, all forms of what they would call violent crimes that is driving mass incarceration. When you look at every booking into the county jail, there are two types of drivers. And the two types that can recite them by heart. Drug possession and delivery. And in every community, is the number one cause or number one cause in those. So what we're doing in the local jail system is we're treating substance abuse and addiction and mental health conditions through policing and incarceration, and we're spending tens of millions of dollars to do it. So what we do in the neighborhood in collaboration with teams is we argue, if you take those tens of millions of dollars out of policing and incarceration, we're spending in Condo and Lancaster and Compton and Oxford, and you put that money into substance abuse services, counseling, education, housing. All of the services and institutions that we need are stronger, healthier, thriving individuals, families, and communities. We will all be safer. Now, this is not the financial, right? We're going to take it out of the institutions of finance and put it into the institutions that keep us safe. An important thing that occurred in 2009 to 2010 was that immediate media attention, because the W did a series on that and it sort of fixed that. With that media attention, I got student attention. And very quickly, a group of students began saying, like, saying, well, you're not going to get your data as media. How can I participate? How can I support this project? I too am part of the community that's most impacted. I want to know what I can do to change the conditions of my family's life, of my life in the community. And so a series of graduate students during the project, who I highlighted in particular, Mike Pestana, who is in the back, who is in the back, as a brand and total union. I had joined the team and brought a different standard to the team, and archives and data and policy and other histories. And with their leadership, we've been able to also bring in a group of undergraduate students into the team. And now about 40 people in the United States research team. We are the only Black, Native, and Brown-led big data team in the country. And no one else is doing the best that we can. I know it's good, right? Okay, so these are undergraduate students, undergraduate students instead of our staff members. We work very, very closely with a group of community-based organizations. This is just a few of them. ACLU, and New World Voice, and many others. And together we've taken this project to new heights that we never imagined. When this project was started, we would not have left it. We now are into a 5-year plan. We're just ready. We began to issue what we call $1 Million Hoods rapid research reports. And I showed you just a couple. We've done many. We got four reports yesterday. Our rapid response there are new schools in policing in the city. For this one, we acquired the school of police, the Los Angeles School of Police Day. We issued two things report, showing two things in particular. One, that 25% of all the arrests by the Los Angeles School of Police is retired in elementary school and middle school. It needs to stay. Second, we say that despite there's been efforts to reform school policing, there's one community of children that is still disparately impacted by it. Law enforcement contact on school. So racial disparities in the and very, very young children are being swept up in very close to the region. This two-case report forced the Los Angeles School Board, or the school district, and Los Angeles School Police to examine it, to negotiate a new way for them. And within 2 weeks, we're going to say, we are participating in that work group. Within 2 weeks, we're going to hear some announcements from the news about the changes that we've been able to learn to school for the state. Two-case report. Another report, we put out on women in the Los Angeles County Jail. This was a part of that, right? It was a movement that we were able to add some new data to that, to help sort of discourage kind of what is to be voted from voting in the jail. Again, I must find one community discreetly impacted by young Black women. And we put out two reports just yesterday, showing the district impact of cannabis enforcement in the last couple of years, largely on Black communities, why it is important as we legalize recreational cannabis, as we create social equity programs. Who gets in line first to get any licenses for your villages and members? Our communities have been disparately impacted and produced and messed up. Our communities need to be at the front of the line in getting those benefits. So what this kind of research is doing is showing this community to vary those contacts at front. So we're showing that African-Americans have been most disparately impacted. On the next page of this, we'll show you exactly which communities in LA have been disparately impacted by cannabis enforcement. And one more thing I'm looking at, there's no way you can see it. But the top you see, every one of those persons today is student to an African American. These are the students, younger students, and myself, and we can be good friends together. So it's really about students get this from the opportunity. Our students have also collected nearly 100 oral histories and testimonies with the residents of LA's million dollar homes to get us a story of life, money, labor, growing up, coming of age, being the million dollar home. How does excessive producing impact our most intimate relationships? All right, before I told you, our community has a story of the vast majority of historical records, and that's what they told me when I was writing the book. Apparently, when you sue them, they find new stuff. So, the Los Angeles Police Department has now transferred it to UCLA. They've got 200 boxes, no less. I've never seen before, never utilized before, historical records of the Los Angeles Police Department. No way. It's definitely. It goes basically from 1965 to the present. The war on drugs is in those boxes. The war on youth is in those boxes. And I'm glad that students are in the working through this. But before we talk about the red wall part, right? Mark Pestana has named this the liberated wall part. Liberated it from other people's questions. And I'm working through it now. Now, when we're doing all this, we've got history. We've got maps, we've got GIS, we've got analysis. We've got statistical analysis, descriptive statistics in particular. We've got testimonies, we've got archives, we've got community, and we've got students. We are writing an equation for reparations. We have taken so much and we want it back for our communities. We are writing an equation for reparations for the fines, the fees, the money there that has stripped our families of much needed resources. So I must tell you that we are the only team that comes to the families to quantify how much money there has been taken for communities. Can you guess how much money there was levied against residents of Los Angeles between 2012 and 2016? I know you know, don't you? spent $20 billion. $20 billion, 2012 to 2016. That's what was left. No, you don't believe me, right? I didn't believe it. Random numbers. $20 billion was levied against the residents of the city of Los Angeles. Not the county, the city of Los Angeles. The vast majority of people couldn't pay that, so you could not secure your constitutional right to freedom before trial. We also were able to quantify how much was extracted from criminals. $200 million. A non-refundable bail bond deposit was taken from residents of Los Angeles to secure their constitutional right to freedom via the private bail bond industry. We can tell you exactly which neighborhood that came from. This is the 14th Block in our Kuna neighborhood. And we know from research that women who came on the bail, we pay the bail to get out their partners, their sons, their families, and neighbors. That money came out of South Central LA, and it came out of contact with Black women and Latinos who needed that money for rent, for transportation, for food, and to build a thriving life for their children. So we want that money back. And let's thank you for that. So reparations for the crimes of seniors in the money bill, reparations for the homes lost, which is explicitly in the wages of need and domestic confinement, reparations for the trauma inflicted in the years of stolen by staff and first policing, reparations for the loved ones taken and harmed by confinement, reparations for the parents taken by deportation, reparations for the children lost to foster care. Where do children go and women go to jail in prison? They're going to prison. And more. So we took all of this data, the numbers, the stories, the archives, that we are collectively writing this equation for reparations. We are also building a new generation of big data analysts. Big data is one of the most diverse fields in this country. And we are really at the cutting edge of bringing in a new group of students to learn big data, to learn GIS, and learn data analysis, to transform all of the systems that are dominated by this new way of thinking. Healthcare, law enforcement, you name it, big data is at the center of it. So this is our first, we just took a picture yesterday right in the middle, our first graduating cohort of students in the Million Dollar Heads team. Yes, I'll see you in the day. I must also say this is an award-winning student team. They have been kicking butt all over the city, the county, and the country. And here they are presenting at Occidental College, their research. Here they are presenting at UC Berkeley. They presented at Columbia University. There they are celebrating their Law Fellows Awards this last year. The UCLA Chancellor has named two of our students as recipients of this year's Service Award. And in the bottom right is here our student a couple of weeks ago. And an honor by Carla, a parent organization, an educated organization in South Africa, influenced to be honored by them. And alongside us on that stage, a student in the country as was the one and only in the West Coast. Our students, our work is on the same type of paper as we're seeing this work, as we see here in the red star. So we are transforming this industry, this field, this way of thinking, in the work that we're doing. How are we able to do it? Because we've put big data into conversation with what matters to students, particularly in first generation students. And some classrooms here at UCLA, if you enter to learn about big data, we're going to talk about how to produce the community. We're teaching students how to use big data to liberate the community. So here are some of our students. They work. I grew up in South Central Los Angeles, and I personally witnessed how it led to the negative impact on the community, and how the police and mass incarceration to breaking up the family. We have $5 million here, which is one way to contribute something bigger than myself, which is progress and change. At home, at school, and even in my community, I saw what was going on, but I didn't know how to put it into terms, and I didn't know what it really meant. But Million Dollar Heads collects data, creates change, creates a change. It puts everything into perspective, explains what's happening to the community. So again, these are words of action. And finally, there are great things. It's very rigorous research, but it's also community-based research. It allows me to give back to the community, but also bring back myself. But the main thing don't just pray about new questions. We ask the community for your intervention. We use the resources we have at UCLA to answer the questions fairly and equipment and with any information. As a public, saving university, we need the community to be able to use us as staff. Our students understand this place much better than some of us. It is the way to the full rest of our community. But the land is our center. The land is the center. We belong to the world of it. And we have the responsibility to utilize our resources, everything, to improve the conditions of life in our first community. And I'm just going to the business case. This is really exciting. Nobody would believe me when I said we're getting students to turn out, showing up and lining up to be able to learn about statistics. Right? You wouldn't believe me if I said that. Well, last week, 2 weeks ago, I came in with the team to let me know we had an open call. And you want to join in my lab next week. I'm going to show you what that looks like. It's 8 seconds. They couldn't get in the room. The teacher. I know. It was a teacher. Yeah. The teacher helped, that's for sure. But what you're seeing is the new generation of big data. And they are lining up to get these opportunities to get in these skills. And they want to learn the way that leads us toward liberation, that helps us to write the equations, the algorithms of our students. So I'm very proud of these students. I can pass you all day, but I don't know if you guys. So this is Moon and I, who is really a university-based, community-driven, student-led program that is really changing the narrative of what is happening with law enforcement and criminalization and addiction and incarceration and criminalizing the case. And moving ahead, we're moving now into crime training and crime therapy and we're expanding across the state of California. We have a 5-year plan to master California. And so we work with additional communities to teach big data skills. We're opening a big data institute this summer, 4 weeks for training here at UCLA for students and community members. And also to just offer the resources of the university to the movements that are working to change the master science. So thank you very much.
Well, I'm sure we'll all agree that Kelly Lytle Hernandez was an important choice for the first part of the list of him. And before we adjourn to the reception outside, I would just like to ask Tom to come in because he would like to say a few words from the Congress and the journal of the Hernandez.
Thank you, Kelly. I think it's not hard to understand why Kelly's first term of incarceration by 400 students and the Constitution of it was a great event. And she spent her time about conveying to the students and doing the research behind what she's going to do.
I want to congratulate Kelly on becoming the first holder of the Lifka chair. We have only begun to see, I think, what the many great things that Kelly is going to achieve during her career as a historian. I hope she's an amazing historian and doesn't get pulled into all kinds of other things, which clearly is a possibility. I think you'll agree after hearing her speak. She's a true scholar, and I'm honored that her name and mine are linked in such an amazing way. Former UCLA Vice Chancellor and UC Vice President Winston Dobie, who brought me to UCLA, once urged that someday I consider providing scholarships for UCLA students. And I have to share with you that by devoting a significant amount from the Lytle Chair funding to support her students, Kelly is helping to fulfill Winston's suggestion. So of the many reasons I have to be proud of
of Kelly, but that's an additional one that's very important. My thanks to Chancellor Jean Block, Executive Vice President Scott Wall, Dean of Social Sciences Darnell Hunt, and Professor Steve Aaron, whose idea it was to work the Lifka chair with the new chair, Keith Kelly at UCLA, that brings us here today. So a special thanks to Steve, who I'm happy is here, for their support, and to the others for their support in making this happen possible. I want to thank also my many friends and colleagues for joining us here today. A special thanks to my friends David Clafter, Doug and Bram Flowers, and Brett Spencer for their generous contributions to the Lifka Professor Fund. I want to thank all the members of the UCLA History Department who graciously gave me the opportunity to teach and remain part of the history profession during the 29 years of my UCLA administrative career, contributing to the ongoing excellence of one of the premier history departments in the nation, certainly provided an important incentive for me to establish this endowment. The endowment of a chair in history really represents, in a broader sense, my thanking UCLA for a great career, and also of honoring the history faculties at Northwestern and Harvard, who were so instrumental in nurturing my academic education. It's remarkable to me still that the enthusiasm I had for reading history as a young boy has led to a lifelong involvement with that subject, which has enriched my life in so many ways, in so many important ways. I feel truly blessed for an ability I never thought I would have to give back to the study of history to UCLA for as long as it exists among the finest universities in the world. Thank you.